We'll still start with the session for the day. As you're aware that during the COVID times, eye care organizations all over the world have had to make a lot of adjustments in the way they work and how they have been kind of managing that. And in the light of that, we have designed this kind of Vision 2020 special session to present what has been the evolving role of eye care organizations during the time of COVID, how they have come up and evolved their roles and are trying to now serve the communities instead of just following their core role. So the session has been designed as a mixture of presentations by two of our partner organizations to begin with, and then a short panel discussion where leaders from some prominent eye care organizations in India, NGOs like Sightsavers, CBM, and Orbis, they'll talk about the priorities and how they are living up to the challenge on that. So that's the session design. I am Dr. Sandeep Bhutan. I am the Global Technical Advisor for Eye Health for Asia for Sightsavers International. And along with that, I'm also the serving chair for Scientific Committee for Vision 2020 India for this year. And I welcome you all to the session. So the first presenter, Mr. Subish, is having a bit of trouble joining in. So I'm inviting Dr. Rajesh Saini, who is the CEO at Greater Lawrence Eye Hospital, Siliguri. He's also the National Coordinator for Vision 2020 India. He would be talking about the responses that their organization has had both during and the intermediate phases of COVID. Dr. Rajesh, go ahead.
Stop. Thank you, sir. I will share my screen now. Hope the screen is visible.
Yes, it is visible. Go ahead, Dr.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Dr. Sandeep. And thanks to All India Ophthalmic Society and Vision 2020 for giving this opportunity. As I am playing a role of National Coordinator at the Vision 2020 Board, so in today's presentation, I will be highlighting few of the Vision 2020 member organizations' response to the immediate needs of the community. So we all are aware of these new terms which we faced last year, lockdown and stay home. So we all face challenges out of this COVID-19 pandemic, which hit all the world last year. The challenges which our health system faced, there is a collapse. The entire focus was on COVID. And it indeed affected eye healthcare system also. All the services affected. Most of the hospitals only gave emergency services during that time. And there is a big, big, big decrease in the cataract surgical rate of all the states. And we also faced an issue regarding the financial sustainability of the hospitals as services are affected. And because of that, the hospitals need to think of the revised payrolls or pay cuts. According to Public Health Foundation of India, because of this COVID last year, the outpatient and the inpatient volume decreased to 75%. Only 25% patients were coming to the base hospital. Though last year, the primary eye care centers responded well as the COVID was not there in the villages. And there was a fear and apprehension that hospitals are COVID transmission hotspots. Mental health issues of the hospital personnel affecting the patient communications with people with disabilities. Vision 2020, the Right to Sight India, is a national forum with stakeholders involving government, INGOs, NGOs, corporate, working together to improving eye care through advocacy, sharing of knowledge and best practices. Today, having a total strength of 158 eye members. The immediate attention last year when needed, our Center of Excellence, LV Prasad, Shankar Eye and Shroff Charity Eye Hospital, obviously referring the AOS guidelines also, came with the concrete guidelines that how we can work in the COVID-19 pandemic. Also with the initiative of Orbis India, there is a concrete guidelines developed to handle OPD, IPD services and all the services in the hospital and in the community to deliver eye services in this new normal. Vision 2020 India members, they responded well to this challenge. And few of the hospitals who really were at the doorstep of the community during this COVID-19, I would like to highlight their work. Trilochan Netralaya, Sambalpur, Odisha. Seva Sadan Eye Hospital, Bhopal. My hospital, Siliguri Greater Lions Eye Hospital. And other hospitals also like Arunodaya Desert Eye Hospital, Neonica Eye Care, and Rotary Eye Hospital, Udhampur, also played an important role. Today, we will be highlighting the work of first three hospitals. Trilochan Netralaya, Sambalpur, they started the work in the first wave immediately. And first, they started delivering the food packets to the labor workers who lost their job during the lockdown. They also provided sanitary kits and soaps and stitched cloth masks by their own staff to the slum dwellers in the Sambalpur area. They donated sunglasses also to the municipality workers and police personnel who were working in the hot summer as frontline workers. With support of Azim Premji Philanthropic Foundation, they distributed dry ration packets to below poverty line in Sambalpur in Kalahandi district. They adopted two government run quarantine centers and provided cooked meals for 2 months. They distributed the immunity booster medicine to the high risk people of Sambalpur as suggested by the district administration. During the second wave, every second person in Sambalpur and third in Bargarh district was COVID positive. And this in turn forced Dr. Shiv Prasad Sahu, the owner, the director of Trilochan Netralaya, to start a 50-bedded COVID hospital in their eye campus. They also joined hands with the government and led a 450-bedded eye hospital for a COVID facility. They extended support of medicine supplies, PPEs, masks, oxygen cylinders, and oxygen concentrator also. Again, they served cooked meals in the second wave. They also started flu clinics, mobile flu clinic, and mobile rapid antigen test for the community. Now, as the vaccination is the key, they started the vaccination, and till now they have provided around 1,800 doses. They are also preparing for the third wave with having a 10-bedded ICU ready, and now they have an oxygen bank of 150 plus oxygen cylinders and 14 oxygen concentrators. Obviously, vaccination they will be planning to do door to door. Now we'll move to the Central India Hospital, which is again one of our important members of Vision 2020 as Seva Sadan Eye Hospital, Bhopal. And they started their work again, partnering with the government and the private hospitals. They provided 40 beds for the expansion of the hospitals for COVID. The nursing staff salary they also provided with the support of the partner Seva Foundation. And service to the mankind with the meals, to the COVID patients, their attendants, funeral service workers, oxygen cylinders, again, oxygen supplies are important key in the second wave, free ambulance services for the COVID patient transportation. These are few of the picks, delivering the dry ration packets to the villages, cooked meals, cylinder, oxygen cylinder delivery, again, the PPE and the medical supplies, bed sheets and sleeper distribution. Siliguri Greater Lions Eye Hospital also started their initiative right from the first wave with support of various partners, delivery of food ration packets to the community, 15,000 plus food packets delivered to the communities at their doorsteps. With the support of Operation Eyesight Universal, 12,000 plus families were benefited with the distribution of hygiene kits during the first pandemic. And also, you can see in the picture that a health worker is suggesting that how people can maintain the hand hygiene. The unit 2, the community hospital of Siliguri Greater Lions, which is a 100-bedded eye hospital, was taken over by West Bengal government in the first wave. And first it was an isolation center and then converted to a safe home. Nearly 1,200 patients benefited with this facility. Jeevan Raksha Oxygen Support Program, as the entire country was facing the oxygen crisis. So a unique project of Siliguri Greater Lions Eye Hospital was adopted by the Lions District 322F also, in which we supplied oxygen cylinders to the mild patients or who need oxygen support at home or at quarantine centers. And this project is now adopted by the various Lions clubs in Siliguri also. Vaccination, with vaccination being the key for achieving the immunity against the pandemic COVID-19, nearly 11,000 plus doses had been provided till to all the members in the Siliguri community with support of the Lions Community Network. We should acknowledge, and we are acknowledging the support of all these donors who supported our these member hospitals in this difficult time of COVID pandemic to provide service for those who are in need. Now, I will end my presentation with a quote from Mahatma Gandhi. Whatever we'll do will be insignificant, but it is very important that we do it. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rajesh, for this lovely presentation where we were able to see that the eye care organizations who conventionally have been quite working as a vertical organization or vertical entity, how they've kind of lived up to the needs of the hour and have started doing activities like distributing food packets and oxygen and now even vaccination. To continue the same kind of thread of thought where how eye care organizations have actually evolved themselves and kind of responded to the need of the hour of the communities that they serve, we have another partner organization who is representing the Central India. Again, these two organizations have been chosen not because they have done, they're the only ones who are working. It's just that this is, represents a sample of how organizations have lived up to it. All organizations, big and small, based on their kind of context, have done massive efforts. And as Vision 2020, we will try to kind of consolidate all of them. But just to give an idea to the ophthalmologists and other people joining this session, some examples. So I invite Mr. Subish from Sadguru Nichiketsale Chitrakoot, Madhya Pradesh, to present how the organization has gone over and beyond and evolved to the need of the hour and is has done the part in responding to the need of the community.
Thank you so much, sir. I think my slide is visible, right, sir?
Yes, we.
Yeah, I'm just putting my video off so that connectivity will be better. So first of all, I would like to thank Vision 2020 and Dr. Sandeep for this wonderful opportunity. I also respect the seniors here, Dr. Praveen Masjid, Dr. Sarah Varghese and all. So basically, I'm here to describe what Sadhguru has done during this difficult time. I mean, when we talk about the previous speaker, Rajesh has beautifully explained how it got impacted to all organizations and what few organizations could do for the benefit of the community where we ultimately stand for. But there were many challenges, but I wanted to focus on two challenges because if you look at it in a broader way, being eye care organization, predominantly work with community outreach camps and all of a sudden we have a dip in our service delivery, which was never expected, just like in the stock market crash. So that was one thing to handle. And another one was now you have a population who are totally unaware what to do and they are poorly equipped because we are working in rural area. Why I'm saying that all of a sudden the dip has a greater challenge because if you look at Sadhguru pre-COVID, you were actually seeing around 2,500 patients, you were doing around 850 surgeries. So all these things, all of a sudden just got into almost zero. So now this become very crucial because you had a good team and it was a huge team to cater this volume. Now all of a sudden they are still there and but there is no work. And we keep saying we are Sadhguru family, so we can't really think of corporate thinking like, you know, so there is no work, so let us reduce or whatever. That cannot happen because we feel Sadhguru was comprised of all the employees, not just other way. And so immediately we took corona coverage rather reducing the salary. And I just wanted to mention, if you look at almost initial first two, three months, you had a lockdown, you compulsory, you had to put notice outside. No, we will only take emergencies. But equally, you need to ensure your staff is being salaried. I mean, I just want to mention, a hospital was actually working for emergency, but in vision centers, we have 60 plus vision centers. We have closed the vision center for exactly for 2 months. But these 2 months also, we ensure everyone is getting salary. And also very happy to share, this year, we have given increment also. This is how the challenge were. One side, you have a low, greater dip in the volume. You have a huge workforce, which you need to carry on without any compromise. So this was a bigger challenge. And one advantage we had was somehow our administrator, Dr. Ilyas Jain, could be being prognosed because a surgeon, because he could sense it, there is going to be an issue.
So, you know, Chitrakoot is a remote location. Supplies in normal situation is very difficult. So in a situation like this, there is not overwhelming demand for the disinfectants or sanitizer and everything. We could procure everything by end of February. And we were fortunate to ensure all the key items are with us to fight the thing. And we also realized we can't really only focus on the supply from external. We also need to bring in. So what we have done for that is we have started the PPE kits and mask production. So with our woman above wing, we have started manufacturing because we could obtain all the raw material. We started PPE kit, gowns and mask manufacturing inside the campus. Initially, we were only developing gowns. Now it got scaled because that was the need of the hour. And everywhere we ensure, so the volume is going to be less, but whatever we do, we need to do with utmost safety of the patients and the staff as well. So we develop protocols. Rajesh also mentioned, we also fortunate to take part in the initiative taken by Office and QAI. I mean, I just wanted to mention, when a situation like this comes in, we all have experience, we all prepare ourselves. But when it comes together, it becomes a beautiful thing where everybody can follow. So that was something very fortunate. And I would say from the volume that dip, to raise it up further again without compromising on safety, Vision was Center was played an integral role because we have around 60 plus Vision Centers. All of a sudden, we stopped the outreach camps, but the Vision Center was able to attract and send patients. And it was also challenging to send them all the materials. And, you know, it become altogether a new norm where people has to wash. And in rural area, it is going to be very tough. And I would say when you start, then people will start following because you. And I think it will keep a lot of confidence to the staff also, because you imagine they are in a village where altogether they have to run the Vision Center. So when you send the safety measures, when you orient them well, so there is enough confidence brings into the staff, which also translates to the patient also. Now I can go to that facility that will be safe. And it replicated in all way. And also you can't just really rely on normal measures. I just want to mention this is basically from the Vision Center patient come to hospital, you have a banner to welcome them. So all these things we are doing to ensure your volume is not too much affected. And also, you know, we have social medias where we send personalized message where the director was mentioning to the community leader because you have stopped the camps and everything. So I'm just saying that we had taken a lot of measures to ensure community engagement. And we also done door-to-door campaigns where you are not transporting. So we were giving allowance to the patient. So all these things were happening mainly because you have to ensure the safety is not compromised. And also the hospital is working. Eventually the eye care who are in need is getting booked. So all these things were done. And I just want to show you the result. You can see here. I just compared the pre-COVID and the COVID year. You can see here, April, May, and June, July. From there onwards, you can see there is an increase in November, December. In fact, January and all, we have crossed what we have done pre-COVID. So this is something very fundamental where eventually with the safety norms, with the guidelines, with the community engagement, you could actually, tackle this challenge very effectively. And I want to show you this. Pre-COVID, you have done 132,000. That was a number. And this year, throughout the year, we had this pandemic challenge. In spite of that, we could do 97,000. This was one thing I wanted to mention. From the beginning itself, we have not reduced our manpower. We have not reduced our salary. We have, in fact, increased this year. And you can see the result now. So that is something fundamental I wanted to share with all eye care providers. Challenges will be there, but be with your team. And if you continuously try to do things, definitely the results are going to be there. And with that, I just conclude the eye care challenge and how do we tackle. Now, the biggest problem was the community where we stand for, because we can't really say we are eye care providers. We are actually providing something which is in need. So we already in the rural situation where problems were many, the awareness and everything was there. And we have taken all steps, including making small videos where making people aware why the mask is required. All small things we were doing, and everywhere we are ensuring somehow patients and the people we are in touch with are getting some information about COVID, how to prepare and what to do and everything. And we also could support the district administration in all possible way. Like I mentioned, we were developing PPE kits and also we were distribute that to district administration to all possible level. And one greater initiative we have taken, Dr. Rajesh also mentioned about the food program. Because one fundamental is food for the hungry. And this region was totally in support because of the COVID, and there are a lot of people who have no food. And we came forward, and we are very fortunate to get support from Mission for Vision. This is a great initiative. This is one example I wanted to mention you that, you know, we work for iCare, and the INGOs also work for iCare. So it was not that easy to ask for them, but they come forward and ask, what are you doing for COVID? Okay, you're doing this. Let me also support. This is how the whole mentality and whole scenario will work. So in the first phase, we could distribute 1,06,000 food packet. And we not only just provided to the normal people for the sadhus and all ration kits and all provided, but again, the next second wave came, it was more severe. So we targeted our 2 lakh, and we have put a Sadhguru Annapurna Vahan, which goes around and ensure we are having a target of 2 lakh, and we are fortunate to get PMG group support for that. So you can see some pictures of food get distributor. And we have a target of 2 lakh plus food packet. For that, around 50% is achieved so far. We are working further on that. And also inside the hospital, because we are fortunate to have a general hospital, but still a lot of eye care staff being supported to this COVID healthcare facility, which was 100-bedded facility, which was with the support of district administration. Again, we could establish 10 ICU beds and 5 high dependency units. Again, we are fortunate to get support from Mission for Vision to equip this high dependency unit and ICUs. And we were fortunate to have a CT scan, which was very crucial in this early prognosis. And also a lot of tests to be done. We were priorly planned for that, and we could ensure all these tests are being done. And another important thing, the supply of oxygen was to where we could get from Singapore Project O2. It was basically to get a lot of oxygen concentrator. We could put 50 beds with oxygen concentrator. You can see here, there were 50 beds with oxygen concentrators. And latest to that, we are establishing an oxygen generator now with the support of Seva Foundation. So this is something where we want to share, because where were we working from the eye care to the oxygen? But when your intent is right and the people are going to be benefited, all organizations will come together for tour. And also we also believe caring the patient who have a COVID is also important, but also equally you need to go for early detection. For that, we had a COVID Arogyam where we go into individual villages and do testing and isolation, and also giving medical kits for the needy. And I would say we have covered a lot of villages. I just named it. So more than 4,000 people got screened, and those who have issues got isolated, referred to facility. And also had vaccination drive. Basically, just to ensure that, and you know, in the beginning stage, it was tough. People were reluctant. Okay, let you all do, then only we go for it. But we started from the top so that everyone follows. And this is actually the vice chancellor of a Gamodaya Vishwavidyalaya, and director is there. So they started taking the vaccine from the initial stage, which saved us a lot, because the second phase hit very worsely. Almost all of our staff got positive, but because they were vaccinated, there was no mortality. I mean, that's something grateful. And now the people are taking it. More than 7,000 people got vaccinated in premises so far. I just wanted to mention a few things to conclude. One thing, we need to be vigilant and we need to be future ready. We were predicting this and we were planning ourselves, and we keep communicating with NGOs, INGOs and all for the support and inspiration. And we always have to work in tandem with the government. And also, you know, you need to think very broadly, rather just thinking about eye care. Because that is a need, because fundamentally you are an organization working for the need in the community, not just for the ailment. And we need to keep progressing, and people will be there to support. Thank you all. And yes, my time is up. Thank you so much. And congratulations, all of you. Thank you, sir.
Yes, thank you, Subish, for the lovely presentation of how an organization which is very connected to the grassroots has actually come up to respond to this challenge and the work that has happened. Extending this discussion slightly beyond single institutions, the next phase of our presentations are essentially, I call it mini panel discussions, but we have invited kind of prominent leaders from various government and non-governmental organizations. We have Dr. Praveen from the API Center. We have Dr. Sara from CBM, Dr. Rajesh, Dr. Rishiraj from Orbis International. So we want to kind of try to get a glimpse of what these organizations have thought as their priorities and what kind of challenges are they facing. So I want to invite Dr. Sara to kind of start that ball rolling and talk about what are the priorities and challenges and the innovations that CBM as an organization and their partners have undertaken during this phase, and we can have that. And again, a request to the attendees, if you have any comments or any experiences, please keep sharing them or questions in the chat box. We will have some time to kind of take them up also. Thank you. Dr. Sara.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks to AIOS for giving Vision 2020 this opportunity, and thanks to Vision 2020 for giving me this opportunity personally. Can you see my screen?
Yes, Dr. Sara, we can see it. Thank you.
Let me just go to full screen. Yeah. Okay. So CBM is a disability and development organization which works not just for eye care, but for other aspects of disability. And I think some of the things I will share have already been mentioned by the previous speakers. For an organization like us, who works through networks around the country and partner organizations, we work with both medical institutions and community-based organizations, community-based development organizations, and DPOs. And some of the things, I think like everybody else, we desired to respond to this crisis. And we were concerned that what we do should be appropriate. I think it helped to be alert. I think by end of February, we saw the writing on the wall and knew that the country was going into lockdown and started getting things ready. Being financially prepared is not about having finances, but having digital systems which will work in lockdown as well. So to get money out where it is needed to account, ultimately you face your auditors, and the Ministry of Home Affairs, so to make sure that things are in place so that you can work like this. I think it is very important to be responsive, to think beyond what we typically do and to think what is the need now. And we saw that with partners. There were people who did say that we are in lockdown, we can't do anything. But the majority of our partners really said, we are out there, we are going to do it. We tried to foster engagement within the team, our own team, and between partners by sharing what they were doing. And we tried to be consultative because we didn't know whether we had all the answers. So we took the opinions of various experts, whether it was eye hospitals, public health specialists, policymakers, and got together people in consultations to see what should be done. It was important both for us and for partners, I think, to have leadership who was committed to responding to this situation. As we work with people with disabilities face particular challenges. They are at higher risk than others. They have difficulty in reaching medical services. There's access, attitudinal barriers. They don't have the information others have, and they have difficulty in distancing. We did a study along with the Public Health Foundation of India on the impact of the COVID crisis on people with disabilities. And, you know, 40% of them were unable to access their routine medical care. They couldn't get also their rehabilitation. They had to post those with pre-existing conditions couldn't get help. This is like everybody else, but exacerbated. We started producing information materials with which we worked with government hospitals to make healthcare providers aware of the particular needs of people with disabilities in the pandemic. Children with visual impairment and other impairments have been totally lost to education. Children from the vulnerable sections are probably never going back to school. This is what the UNICEF study has shown. But so when parents don't have access to mobile devices, we started setting up community learning centers. There was a profound effect on livelihoods of people with disabilities. Nearly all were forced to borrow money. They had to borrow money even for basic necessities. And our approach was community participation, often led by people with disabilities, collaboration with the district administration, collaboration with other NGOs, and making sure feedback mechanisms and safeguarding mechanisms were in place. People with disabilities were not just receiving, they were also contributing. A farmer producer organization set up by us gave their entire profits for the financial year to the district administration. So like others have shared, we went around distributing masks, hand sanitizers, PPE kits, gloves. And over actually 10 crores of support was given in 2020. I really have to thank our partners who were out there in the field doing all this work, who were so ready to take on the various responsibilities. Over 300,000 people got direct benefits, 30,000 people with disabilities, access to psychosocial services, access to health and hygiene care, working with hospitals, children accessing education, training teachers on COVID response. I'm just picking up a few of these and supporting e-commerce platforms for people in livelihood interventions. These were some of the longer term COVID responses, which are still going on. Telehealth and rehabilitation, tele and mobile eye care, marketing FPO products through e-commerce, and education through a blended learning. I think when it came to the 2021 second wave, this was, I think, far worse than the first wave. And we had to think again, you know, what do we do in this situation? What else? And we definitely began to feel we need to equip hospitals who have the capacity to provide oxygen, CBOs who can provide oxygen, ventilator beds, ICUs. And again, approximately 10 crores is being invested this year. Again, this time you will see that besides the rations, the education kind of part, the community work, there's a lot of work with hospitals, equipping, upgrading hospitals, upgrading COVID wards for people with disabilities, and providing oxygen concentrators, other equipment, both to communities and to hospitals, to people who have the capacity to use them relevantly. Another project and another two projects like this are starting about helping people now access vaccination. We are not providing vaccinations, but facilitating people with disabilities in particular who would otherwise not get vaccination, access vaccination. So ultimately, what are our learnings? I have written an article on this, which is published in the Australian Journal of Public Health. There's a need, and this is not just for us, who is a network organization, but for every organization. There's a need for organizational agility to think beyond the box in these kind of situations, to think beyond what we are used to doing. One needs to have strong systems. One needs to empower people at the grassroots and at the bottom of the pyramid, of the organizational pyramids. They are the ones who are in touch with the field, who can tell you what is needed, and you give them the authority to do it, to take those decisions. Ultimately, it's about having organizations with heart. We, as individuals, we respond from our heart, but as organizations also, we need to feel for the situations and the difficulties our people, these are all our people, our fellow Indians were suffering. We see, we listen, we are present. And ultimately, there is humility also. Whatever we do, we know it is a drop in the ocean of demand. We started our response actually with a 3 lakh rupees from an emergency fund when migrants started walking down the road from Delhi to Agra last year, the pictures from the Agra highway. And we knew that it was nothing in the face of demand. But we thought that we needed to contribute our small drops to the ocean of demand. And this is what is needed for all organizations. We need organizations with heart. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sara. I think some of these are quite inspirational to others also. And as you said, that it's more important to do organizations with heart rather than be driven only by your focused objectives or the project aims as such. So continuing the same kind of line of thought, I'm inviting Dr. Rishiraj Bora from who's the country director for Orbis International to kind of present how their organization has evolved and kind of responded to the needs of the hour. Dr. Rishiraj.
Thank you, Dr. Sandeep. And thanks to AIOS and Vision 2020 for giving me this opportunity or giving Orbis this opportunity to participate in this session. Can you see my screen?
It should be coming. Are you? Yes, we can see it. Go ahead. Thank you.
So regarding Orbis's work during this pandemic, or priorities and challenges and the learnings from this experience during pandemic, I would like to talk about first the Orbis's
please slide slow your screen. Okay, sir.
So this through Orbis vision is to transform lives, and our mission is to work with our partner institutions across India. We mentor, train, and inspire local teams to provide services in the community. Our priority area for last 20 years is childhood prevention of childhood blindness. We continue to do it also during this pandemic time. It is because the prevalence of blindness among children is 0.8 per thousand, and maximum number of blind children across the world resides in developing countries like us. And in India, it's near about 200,000 to 300,000 children who are blind. Around this priority, with through approaches we adopt. Normally adopted, like building partner hospitals capacity to ensure continuity of care to the children, we support training and infrastructure and equipment for the partner, and then making eye care services accessible to children in the community through our children's eye care network. Over the 20 years, we built 33 children's eye care centers across 17 states. So talking about the challenges during COVID-19, I think my fellow speakers and partner institutions, two of our partner institutions talked about this decline of number of beneficiaries reached during this time. The same thing was seen in other partner institutions we work with in India. While adopting the COVID-19 protocol, I think reaching out to community or reaching out to people who need eye care took more time and increases the project implementation costs. Ensuring staff and then patient safety caregiver and care receiver safety was also a challenge during this time. And then delay and interruption in the program implementation, service delivery, and on-site training was also a challenge. Dealing with an implementation team with a low morale given the pandemic is also one of the challenges for all our partners while providing services during this challenging time. Talking about the learnings, I think the collaborating with the representative and the government operational systems for better community acceptance, this came up in many of our partner institutions because the community health worker working in the government keep in touch with the community for a long period of time. They have a rapport there. I think providing eye care services through them or including them while providing the eye care services during the pandemic, acceptance has gone up in the community. So I think that is one learning out of that, that know how government machineries and then operational system can be work with and then reach out to many people in during this pandemic. So Vision Van has also played a key role in some of the partner institutions going out and then providing services in the areas where the eye care need is there. Service delivery shift from field to fixed facilities. Like initially a lot of camps were supported and things like that. During this time, it was not possible, but establishing Vision Center was one of the options that we got, that now bringing the eye health services closer to the community. One more thing that we tried and then it got, apart from establishing these vision centers, until unless we connect the household to the vision center through house-to-house screening, it's more of a kind of primary screening, identify people, refer them to the vision center for referral care. That was one of the learning out of this thing. And then COVID-19 risk management also, what we did, all the places we reach out to, like through vision centers, our partners reach out to vision centers, vision van, and then house-to-house screening. We make it a point including COVID-appropriate behavior awareness along with the eye health awareness, like hand hygiene and then importance of wearing masks and things like that. That was also included in our awareness program when we provide care for eye health. Remote mentorship and then training. I think we conduct a lot of hospital-based training program, bring in experts from within country and then outside. Stay there in a particular hospital for providing hands-on trainings for 1 week, which was not happening because of this pandemic. What we did, we converted entire hospital-based training program concept to a virtual hospital training based training program, so we can still create an environment with the support from technology, bringing the mentors and then mentees together in a platform where learning can still go on. So Orbis work during this COVID-19, 2 points I'd like to mention here. It is about leveraging technology to continue our mission. First point around this Flying Eye Hospital program, we planned, you know that Orbis is known for this Flying Eye Hospital program, and then this goes to different developing countries to train the local teams. But in 2020, we were supposed to have a Flying Eye Hospital program with a theme of simulation in ophthalmology. We could not do it because of the pandemic. But immediately we have transformed this physical Flying Eye Hospital to a virtual Flying Eye Hospital program. And through our telemedicine platform, CyberSight, we conduct a virtual environment where all the trainees and then mentors were connected. And then at the end of the two weeks program, more than 160 professionals were trained in the intended training that we were supposed to do in a physical training. We could complete with a virtual event. Unlocking possibilities during lockdown series, that is basically bringing out all the great work our partner, two of the partner institutions have mentioned. So all this great work were brought in through a series for a consumption of a wider audience. That during this pandemic also, our partner institution has done a lot of work in terms of eye care. So that we wanted to highlight and then motivate other institutions also to take up all these programs. So that's what the Unlocking Possibility series we had done. COVID relevant webinar on website. Our latest, we had done a mucormycosis webinar in the COVID era, which is basically to bring out and then showcase that it is not only ophthalmology. I think it is sometimes it requires a multidisciplinary approach to deal with a problem like mucormycosis. So with the expert from Shroff Charity Eye Hospital in Delhi and Sir Gangaram Eye Hospital came together and then showcased that, you know, how a multidisciplinary approach can help dealing with the problem like mucormycosis. Last 20 years of our work, we took this opportunity to utilize this time to put together everything that we had done in 20 years in terms of prevention of childhood blindness and putting up a kind of one point of resource or repository for childhood blindness prevention in form of a status of eye health report in India. Developing clinical guidelines, this was mentioned already by the speakers, I think. And then third, means last point I'd like to mention about continuity of care. Through establishment of vision centers or green vision centers, bringing the primary eye care services to the community. Second, connecting these vision centers services through household screening and inclusion of COVID appropriate behavior in our eye care awareness program, all our partners do. So thank you so much for this opportunity. And thank you, Dr. Sandeep.
Thank you, Dr. Rishi, for the lovely presentation on how Orbis has responded to that. And we can see that all of the aspects of care has been covered, whether it is setting up guidelines or training people or just trying to manage technology to ensure continuity of care. We also have amongst us Dr. Praveen Vashesh, who is the head of community ophthalmology department at the RP Center of Eyesight, and they are also advisors, technical advisors to the National Program for Prevention of Blindness and Visual Impairment. So at this point, since we've been talking about the non-governmental part of the sector, I would like to take the opportunity to maybe ask Dr. Praveen, what has been the response from the government and the government institutions, whether it is at district level, government level, what has been some of the responses from the government which you would like to share with us regarding this?
Sorry to interrupt you, Doctor, but with all your due respect, I would request you to please wind up the session within 5 minutes. We have our next session.
Sure. Thanks, ma'am. So Dr. Praveen is the last speaker and his word will be the last one. I wouldn't take any further.
Doctor, we have a session at 1:30.
No issue. And I don't have any PowerPoint presentation. Yeah. I'll be speaking extempore.
Sure.
In fact, first I would like to congratulate all the partners and INGO partners that they have taken such a good initiative during this difficult time. It was such a difficult time that even best of the health system was a failure, besides not only in India, but the other countries also. Luckily, I belong to AIIMS, the apex healthcare institute in the country in government sector. And I am a bit aware how the leadership role has been taken by our institute, especially our director, Dr. Rundeep Guleria. In fact, used to have daily meetings. I know other people were sitting at home, but all our leaves were canceled, vacation were canceled, and we have to come here daily. And in our director office, in auditorium, we used to have all the faculty members, daily meetings, daily changes, daily policy changes were there in relation to COVID. And we were following these. All the OPDs were stopped, all surgeries were stopped, only emergency care was there. Entire institute was converted into COVID hospitals. No, those things were there. And how the normal people will get services. Of course, tele-ophthalmology services were started. A common group of all the faculty members and residents were there, were providing facilities to the patient directly. Each and every patient who were aware of that group, they are able to request their queries and we're responding to those queries. There's something very helpful for even the local people, general community. Those things were there. I'm very happy to share that we have also taken the leadership role in developing the vaccine. AIIMS was partnered to Bharat Biotech, and we were involved in basically primary testing for piloting this co-vaccine. My friend from community medicine, he was the principal investigator for our site, and we're very happy that ultimately that vaccine is now being considered one of the best vaccine for COVID in India, at least. And there's something very special. We were vaccinated during trial time only in January itself. So that's something very nice to share and something. As far as ministry is concerned, eye care program is concerned, we were surprised and shocked that entire thing was almost stopped. We requested that special guidelines should be developed. So that we had guidelines related to community ophthalmology care. We got guidelines. We requested Dr. Pramila Gupta that as early as possible, special guidelines should be given for restarting the services, whether it is a routine eye care services or even for eye banking and keratoplasty services. So fortunately, those guidelines were developed, and we were part of those guidelines. If I compare the situation 2020, the outputs as far as our cataract surgeries and corneal blindness issues are concerned, you will be surprised to know that every year we were conducting nearly 65 lakh cataract surgeries. And when I saw the output of 2020-21, it was hardly 35 lakhs, nearly 50% reduction in cataract surgeries. Number of cornea collection, we had a target of 75,000 cornea collections, and it was hardly 25,000 corneas were collected in the entire year. So you can understand that the output was reduced significantly by more than 50% as far as eye care is concerned. So it was very important that routine services should be started as early as possible. As far as our personal community ophthalmology section is concerned, in fact, we have tried that we should continue with the community eye care programs as much as feasible. So except in the lockdown period, our services were there, our team were available for providing primary eye care services. We had 28 vision centers, and out of them 18 vision centers were continuing to provide primary eye care services. As far as rehabilitation work is concerned, I'm very thankful to CBM that our team continue to provide. In fact, Dr. Suraj is there in our department. We kept 4 people. They were directly counseling the patient directly, the patient or the student from school for the blinds. So daily their counseling, their support, any kind of support they needed, we are trying from our side to help. So this is something very positive. And one more thing which I would like to share, how we can utilize our work. We got a project from Orbis regarding human resource and infrastructure. When our team was not there in committee, nearly 30 people, they were there to collect information about human resource and infrastructure. I'm glad to share that we were able to collect data from 8,000 institutes all over the country. And now this is probably the most important work which we could have shown to entire country that even this information is available with us. I think I should not speak much. Time is not there. So thank you very much.
Thank you. I'll thank all the speakers and people who have attended the session. Thank you all. And please feel free to get in touch with the Vision 2020 team if you have any comments or suggestions on that. Thank you all the speakers again, and over to the next session. Thank you all.
Thank you.